give you some idea. 2 miles then is the oval front straight, 3,000. Well, I don't need to read it to you, do you? 45 feet. And let's cross then to our commentators at trackside, who are, I think, Gary Lee and former IndyCar driver, of course, Larry Rice.
Frank Keating's helmet as the crew was adjusting that left side mirror for him. See how small that thing is? And yeah, you can see what's going on behind him at 200 plus miles an hour.
That's a great shot of exactly what he can and what he cannot see. You know, there's not a lot that he can see. You can see the tire takes up a lot of the space in that mirror. So, you know, you can see on either side of it, and, you know, it's just not as much as you would think it would be.
But a driver has a certain feeling, though. I mean, you feel what's around you in addition to seeing what's
right
around you.
Right. You can hear, you can feel, you can see. It's all those things that are part.
And some of these drivers have felt a lot more this season with some contact.
There's a few of them that just kind of run over and nudge you a little bit. Plus, your spotters help you a lot, too. That's what they really rely on.
Well, as you can see, all the drivers now are in the cockpit. Thumbs up there from Scott Sharp. As they're strapped in, we're only moments away from the command from Gordy Johncock, our Grand Marshal. Live coverage from Michigan International, the Michigan Indy 400. Gary Lee and Dan Weldon second in the third. Well, obviously somebody gave him an additional 500 win there because he's a two-time winner in 1973. The rain shortened affair that year and again in 1982.
But you notice he did not say one extra word. He said,
no,
gentlemen,
start your engine. That was
all.
It. And one by one, the crews will raise an arm indicating to the pace car and the officials up in front of the field that their car has started. Johnny Rutherford, who is a three-time winner of the Indy 500, will be on board the pace car.
Now this should be a great race. Every race that we've had here with the IRL has been a really, really good race. Drafting is so important. If you can stay in that lead.
Tony Kanaan, car number 11.
Kosuke Matsuda, car number 55.
Scott Dixon, car number 1.
Sam Hornish Jr., car number 6.
Vito Almeida, car number 17.
Buddy Reich, car number 15.
Townsend Bell, car number 2.
Dan Weldon, car number 26.
Brian Herdak, number 7.
Adrian Fernandez, car number 5.
Dario Franchitti, car number 27.
Darren Manning, car number 10.
Thomas Scheckter, car number 4.
Alex Barron, car number 51.
Ed Carpenter, car number 52.
AJ Foyt-Ford, car number 14.
Mark Taylor, car number 13.
Scott Sharp, car number 8.
Jacques Lazier, car 20.
Andrew Castroneves, car number 3.
Felipe Giafone, car number 24.
Kula Badagi, car number 12.
Take a look now from on board inside the helmet cam of Dario Franchitti.
Okay, 200 laps, 400 miles. Tony Kanaan on the pole. Last year's winner, Alex Barron, after a spin, and the pit window is going to be very important, 38 to 42 laps. But a lot of these guys on that first pit stop will come in a little bit early just to make sure what the fuel mileage is.
There's the onboard with the Scott Dixon. We'll have two more laps before we turn them loose. Scott Dixon starting inside the second row, the third spot. That's his best start so far of the season, driving with that brace on the thumb.
Well, he's really looking forward to this race because it is, he feels, the best chance he's had all year. He's had some bad luck. There we ride along with Townsend Bell, another guy who has a very good starting spot and is very happy with his race car and the new horsepower. Toyota and Chevrolet have both got some more horsepower as we ride along with Thomas Scheckter.
Thomas Scheckter starting back in 13th position. There's Scott Sharp, who's starting back in the 18th spot. There has been some talk, Larry, that the Hondas could have about 35 horsepower more than the other cars, which represents about a 5% increase.
Yeah, that's quite a bit. Now we ride along with Darren Manning. We look out the back of his cars. He did not get quite as good a qualifying speed as he wanted today.
There is Franchitti. We could call that the nose camera. We can see his nose there in the lower left.
Yeah.
Franchitti, who won at Milwaukee on the Milwaukee Mile just a week ago.
Now, this is probably not as good a qualifying position as he would like to have had for this race, and I'm sure he's not happy with that. But realistically, if you look at this field, there's about 15 cars in this field that could win this race. And I think you'll see come the end of the race, there'll probably still be 9 or 10 cars in the lead pack, depending on attrition, that could win this thing.
Field is very ragged right now, but they have one lap to get in starting order behind the pace vehicle driven by Johnny Rutherford.
Right, and it'll be interesting to see how quickly Castroneves comes up to the pack. I think starting back in 20th, he'll be moving up there pretty quickly. Darren Manning, as the guy starts back in 12th, he'll be moving up. But there's so many fast cars in here, it's going to be difficult once you get to the top five.
Top five finishes in 9 races this season. Look at Tony Kanaan. That is exactly how you win a championship. Not only has he won 3 races, but finished 8 times in the top 5, and he's completed every lap of competition.
Well, that's the amazing thing. Not wishing him any bad luck, but sooner or later, a race of luck is going to catch up with you, and you are going to fall out of a race, at least one during the year, I would think.
And taken out of a race in a crash.
Well, that happens, too.
You see how wide this racetrack is? See how wide the turns are? Only 5-degree banking here on the backstretch into 18-degree banking in the corner.
And this
hit the green, Larry, this time by.
Yeah, and this is the very tense part of the race for the drivers. It's all anticipation. Once that green flag drops, it kind of goes away. But right now, that's Castroneves back there. They're showing way in the back of the pack. And we'll kind of watch him as he motors his way through.
No start. Calling off the starts. Somewhat ragged about halfway through the field.
Yeah, I'm not sure
what. Two or three rows look pretty good.
Yeah, the first 2 rows, and then I'm not sure. From back that, they're falling way back.
Race control simply not happy with the way they were lined up. There's Ashley Judd, the wife of Dario Franchitti. And so they'll go one more lap before we turn them loose.
Well, with fuel being as important as it is at that racetrack, this is not exactly what these drivers wanted to see. They're ready to go. The good thing about having radios is you don't have any false starts. You don't have anybody on the gas running over somebody. They were all told plenty in advance on the radios that there was going to be no.
That came directly from race control.
Right, exactly.
Did not go through a spotter or somebody else.
Right. Race control has the ability to talk to every driver. Now then, they're going to try to get them back in line in 2x2s, and they wanted a little more space too, I think. The second row was right up the back wing of the front row, and I think they want them to give a little bit more space when that start happens too.
There's a look at Sam Hornish, who starts outside the second row, outside Scott Dixon, who starts inside row 2.
Two Toyotas, probably the best couple of Toyota starts we've seen for a while.
Well, still kind of ragged mid-pack.
It's real ragged.
Well, I'm trying to be kind.
No, exactly.
It's real ragged.
It's real ragged, yeah.
But the green flag flies, and look at this. No, it didn't start. They came back with the yellow. They were going green, Larry, and they came back with the yellow at the last moment.
Well, that's because Buddy Rice in that the 55 car. Buddy Rice in the 15 car, excuse me. He laid back. I've had the name right. I had the number wrong. See Buddy Rice back there in that third row? He's way, way back behind those guys. He's trying to get a run on them. And Matsura, in the meantime, he didn't get up to speed. He wasn't up with the lead pack.
And so, as a result, Dixon was going by him, so there were several problems there.
Yeah.
So they waited off the last moment. But again, fuel begins to play a problem. This is 2 extra laps.
That's right. It's 2 extra laps, and they only get so much fuel for this race. And last year, there was a huge problem. Again, Buddy Rice and Matsura both laying back a little bit.
They work off the corner with a green flag fly this time.
They've done the same thing every time. It's just not been a good start.
But Matsura is not getting a real good start.
That was better than
green
the last
flag
time.
Does fly, and they go 3 wide immediately. Look at this. And there goes Hornish to the high side. 3 wide into the 18-degree banking of turn 1.
That's
still 3 wide.
Matsura just did not get going for whatever reason. And look at Castroneves already on the hammer, passing 2 or 3 cars back there in the back of the pack.
Well, Kanaan is out in front. He has led the most laps so far this season. In the 6 races that he's led 474 laps, and add one more now as he comes around to complete lap number 1 here of 200.
Yeah, Scheckter was very wide. Now we see them three wide again going down in here. Vito Mira in the middle.
Right next to his teammate on the outside. And Dixon down low. Mira goes by on the high side. Oh, look how close they got coming off the corner.
Wow. Mira took a huge run right there. Went in between his teammate, Buddy Rice, and Dixon.
Yeah,
and pulled
Dixon.
It off. Yeah, wow. What a good... Yeah, it was a great job. It was a little bit scary from where we were sitting.
Now, Schechter's moved up a couple of positions from the start.
And here
There's
comes Hornish.
There's a look at Hornish in the number six. He's back in fourth position. Goes by Weldon for a position, so he's up to third. Weldon drops to fourth. Mira is fifth, then Dixon, then Rice. And look at Schechter all over Darren Manning. This is the battle for eighth position.
Once again, all these drivers trying to use the draft to their advantage. Now you can see him getting in behind Manning, getting a little bit of a pull, and then he pulls out and tries to go around him.
There's Herta behind him. You hear the rev limiter?
Yep, just barely hit the rev limiter right at the very end. Now he just gets a good run around the outside of Manning and just blows on by him going down the back straightaway.
Now this is Chevrolet power. You see the Chevy bow tie there on the rear wing. That is Schechter, who is now in 10th position.
Now look at Castro Nevis.
Look at Castro Nevis going by Herta.
He went around
him to 11th.
He went around Brian Herta like he was pulling into the pits or something. Man, oh man, he just blew by him right in the middle of 3 and 4.
Well, you talked about most teams made an engine change before qualifying. Penske elected to go with the same engine they practiced with, and that engine was good enough for a second spot on the grid, but it started overheating. They elected to change the engine and go from the back of the pack.
Well, you're only allowed one engine change on the weekend. This was a three-day weekend instead of a two-day weekend. Most of the races they run are only 2 days now, but they practice on Friday, qualified on Saturday, and raced on Sunday. So most of the teams changed their engines on Friday night. Castro Nevis did that, but then they had an overheating problem on Saturday and they had to change again. Therefore, he had to go to the back of the pack.
Look at Buddy Rice on the high side. We talked about watching him go three wide here at Michigan. He's way out there.
Wow. He was really wide. He got back around Mira, but look at this. Castro
Nevis. This is the battle for third, fourth, and fifth. And look at Mira right behind his teammate Buddy Rice and right behind Mira and Schechter. And they stay up on the high side.
Schechter looked like he thought about going four wide on the outside of those guys, and they've been running. We talk about side-by-side racing, but very seldom do you see three-by-three racing. They've been doing this now for about two laps.
Well, obviously, Mira thinks that his teammate has the fastest car of that threesome there because he stays up on the high side. You're right with Schechter. He remains on the high side as well.
Wow, these guys... pretty great. That's pretty far out there. No marbles up there yet, but later in the race, they may not be able to do
now
that.
They drop off to side-by-side, and here comes Schechter alongside of Weldon.
Yeah, Weldon seems to be the guy that lost there. As you see Castro Nevis back there in the background, he's gaining on this whole group.
And there goes Rice into third position. Here comes Mira right behind, and here comes Schechter on the high side around Mira.
Wow.
And so Schechter picks up a position around Mira. Schechter now up in the sixth position as he goes around Vito Mira. Adrian Fernandez started 10th. He is currently 8th. And there is Castro Nevis behind him in 11th.
Yeah, Castro
Nevis. Or 9th, that is. And Castro Nevis started at the back of the pack in 20th.
Right. He got around the first 10 cars pretty easily. But when he got to that top 10 pack, things slowed down quite a bit because it's not near as easy to blow them off as it was those first guys.
Also, 12 laps now complete, 4/10 of a second between first and second. Rice is third, Schechter fourth, then Hornish, Mira, Weldon, Fernandez, Castro Nevis, and rounding out the top 10 is Brian Herta.
You see Fernandez there. He just seems to be riding along. Castro Nevis following him in the draft, hasn't been able to do much with him since he caught up with him. Weldon in front of those two. And everybody seems to have settled in now, kind of happy to be in the pack and running, except maybe for Schechter, who's still trying to get her.
Schechter's never happy. In fact, we talked earlier about the fact that his very first driving coach, Keith Forey from South Africa, has been here in America the past 3 weeks watching his Fry student. He took him on as an 8-year-old in karts.
Right, you can see how important the draft is. He just sucks in behind Hornish. Hornish did the same thing to him down that last straightaway and got around him. Now then, though, Hornish down a little bit shorter distance down on the bottom, so he gets through the corner a little bit faster. But you should be able to keep your RPMs up on the outside. And here Hornish kind of sucks up behind him, pulls out again. Nope, don't think he's going to make that pass.
So this is the battle now for fourth position. That is Hornish in front of Schechter. You ride with Schechter. Right behind Schechter is Mira, then Weldon, Fernandez, and Castroneves. So Castroneves, who started this race back in 20th, now move to the inside, down to that white line. Is he going to have room?
Wow.
I guess Hornish gave him room.
I guess he did.
He forced the issue there. Schechter forced the issue.
Yeah, he went down to the bottom where he hasn't really run all day long. As we look at Buddy Rice now, he takes over second place. That's around that syrup.
So Buddy Rice now starting to reel in your leader. Kanaan has led all 15 circuits. Rice is now second. Matsura, his best start of the season, in second position. On the start, now drops to third. Schechter is fourth, then Hornish and Mira.
Well, Matsura doesn't have the experience here that Rice has. We'll see if he learns about the drafting and how it all works very quickly, because if you know the draft and how to work it, you can make some passes on this racetrack. As you take a look back there, Schechter and Hornish and Vito Mira right behind them.
And Dixon back in 13th position. Now, when we talk about drafting, you really have to credit all the tech guys with the Indy Racing League that they have developed a chassis where these guys can, in fact, draft, that it does not disturb the air so much behind the car that you can't get that close.
Exactly. You can hear right there why Dixon is falling back to 13th. He's lifting coming off the corners just ever so slightly. Now, listen this time, see if you can hear it again. Nope, didn't do it that time. But coming off of two, he really lifted because the car started taking off on him, and you just can't do that here. Now, you notice they run nose to tail down the straightaways, but when they get to the corner, they peel off. That's the reason they don't run. They run two and three wide. If you're right behind that guy, it's going to take the air off your front wing, so you can't follow him right exactly through the corner. You got to move off to one side or the other.
Of course, that takes away your downforce, and the car tends to want to push at that point. So Hornish moves up a little bit. Schechter is fourth, Hornish is fifth, and there's Vito Mira, who is stalking both of them. So Kanaan has led all 17 laps. Rice is second.
Boy, Hornish is really close going down the straightaway. Looks like he's almost going to touch him, and didn't do it, though. Pulled out right at the very end, trying to get around. This doesn't look like he's got the speed, even though he gets a little bit of a gain, a little bit of a pull down the front straightaway. He doesn't have the speed at the end of the straightaway to go around him on the outside.
Now, keep in mind, these three guys are battling with three different power plants. You have Chevrolet in the yellow car, Toyota in the Marlboro Penske, and that's a Honda with Vito Mira. Now, there's a big question mark, Larry, as to the future of Chevrolet. They have not committed to the Indy Racing League for next season.
No, they haven't, and a lot depends on what happens. They've come up with this new improved engine here over the last couple of weeks. If they do not perform well, then you're probably not going to see them back. Right today, it looks pretty good for them, though, as Schechter doing a great job up there battling as he goes to the outside of Matsura. Look at that. That's your lead
car.
Two, four, six cars. And Schechter just goes around Matsura. Hornish follows him around the outside, and here comes Mira, too.
Right now, the top six cars separated by less than 1 second.
Matsura went from third to sixth in one gasp of breath right down the front straightaway.
And then he was probably holding his breath as that
probably
happened.
Probably was.
Riding back along with Schechter. And that is Rice up there in second. You saw him shift gears. And right in front of Rice is Kanaan. So we've only had one leader so far today. Kanaan started from the pole position, his first pole of the year. He's done everything else. He's won races. He leads the league with the most wins with three. He's led the most laps. He's completed every lap of competition, but up until this weekend had yet to secure a pole position.
It's amazing how they shift gears with so few RPMs. You can't even hear the difference in the RPMs in that engine, and they're still shifting gears just by losing 200 or 300 RPMs.
Castroneves now back to eighth position after starting 20th. Weldon is in ninth.
Yeah, Weldon has fallen off a little bit. Castroneves has been poking away pretty steadily, though, and he's proven he's got a fast car.
Back, it's the gap there between first and second, Kanaan and Schechter, which amounts to about 0.2 of a second.
Yeah, no matter what's happened, Kanaan has been able to hang on. You can see that draft, how Scheckter pulls up about a car length down that straightaway. Then he has to move up going through the corners. Now then, here comes Buddy Rice back around the outside of Hornish.
And here comes Vito Mira. A little draft from his teammate. And he goes up even higher on the racetrack. So Rice goes to third. Hornish is still fourth, but he's being pressured by that car of Mira. Up in front, Kanaan, with now then less than 0.2 seconds over that yellow car of Scheckter. Scheckter won here 2 years ago, and there's the battle for fourth. And here comes Matsura back in sixth position. Vito Mira trying to get the high line around Sam Hornish.
Buddy Rice back in the hunt now as he's gaining a little bit on Scheckter right now.
And Scheckter appears to gain on Kanaan. Catching is one thing, passing
is
something
else. Yeah,
that's
right. He seems to gain on him. He's never been within about, he gets within about a car length or two car lengths. That's about all the closer he can get. Even with that draft down the straightaway, Kanaan seems strong enough through the corners that he cannot gain on him through the corners at all.
Look at Scheckter's ride through the pack. He won this race 2 years ago.
This is as close as he's been.
Position.
This is the closest he's been to Kanaan all day long.
Yeah, and this is making a statement, Larry, on a really fast racetrack. This is making a statement that Chevrolet has found something to close that gap. If, in fact, Honda had enjoyed a 35-horsepower advantage in weeks past, it doesn't look to be the case here this afternoon.
35-horsepower is huge. Now, let's see. This seems to be where he gains. He gains on him through 3 and 4 down the front straightaway and then loses coming off of turn 2.
Vito Mira still working on Sam Hornish for that fourth position. And they are side-by-side on the racetrack. There's Matsura, who started in second. Right behind them, back in the sixth position. Fernandez is sixth, or seventh. Weldon, eighth. Castroneves, ninth. And tenth is Dario Franchitti.
Mira got a good run off of two that time. This is probably going to propel him on past Hornish. Although Hornish doesn't give up. Just keeps his foot down at the bottom. Stays on the bottom of the racetrack.
Of course,
believe
that's
me,
the shortest way around this racetrack.
Well, and both these guys are running absolutely flat out. There's no lifting here. It's just a matter of what kind of a draft you get from the cars in front of you. Kind of a little bit of a break you get, because if you just pop that throttle just for a fraction of a second, that guy's going to go on by you. We're getting close to pit stop time. We've run 33 laps. These guys are all going to be thinking about coming in here in the next 5 or 6 laps. They're not sure about fuel mileage. We've talked to some of the teams. They said they'd pit about lap 36, so shouldn't be long before we start seeing our first
pit stop. Remember, we went
Matsura's coming in right now.
We went 2 extra laps before the green flag came out.
Yep. Oh, hard on the brakes. Came in a little hot. Yep, so Matsura was the first of the leaders to head for pit row.
His best starting position today. He started in second position, had been back there in sixth when he peeled off to make the pit stop. It was Kanaan, Scheckter, Rice, Hornish, and Mira in the top 5 positions here on lap 35. And we would expect most any lap now to see the entire field.
That was a terrible pit stop. Terrible pit stop. The guy on the right rear had some problems, and it's going to cost him.
Mira, Hornish, Castroneves in the pits. They're drag racing down pit road despite the pit speed limit.
Wow. Mira taking a chance there. He's cut inside of Hornish. Hornish had to slow up. That'll cost him a little bit of time.
Adjustment of the front wing. Castroneves away. Hornish is away, number 6. And they got by Mira, so a slow pit stop for the Ray Hall Letterman team.
Yeah, Castroneves got by him. Of course, he was running in the back. Here come your leaders. Here comes Thomas Scheckter. Buddy Rice. Oh! Scheckter again has troubles. He runs over a tire.
And ran over a crew member as well. And that could finish Thomas Scheckter, depending on what damage may have been done to that left front.
You see
the wing is askew. They'll have to replace the nose. You talk about the luck that this kid has had this year. He's had no luck. It's all been bad.
Everything that's happened has gone wrong. And this is just another example of it. Looked like somebody laid a tire out there. He just ran over it as he came in. They're really mad. You can see him yelling, and whoever's on the other side of the pits up there, boy, they hot at them.
Whose tire was it he hit?
I don't know, but this is virtually taking him out of the race. What a terrible, terrible break for Panther Racing and for Thomas Scheckter. Now you can see these guys are falling all over themselves. They're all discombobulated, all out of whack, trying to get, they're going to lose a couple of laps here. Just terrible.
Franchitti is in and out, and now they're about to pull the leader off the track as he has led 37 laps, the first 37 laps. And we'll see who will assume the lead as he comes to the attention of the Andretti Green Team.
Well, let's see if they don't see if they can get in and out without having any problems. It looks like everything going very smoothly so far. The first caution is out, but it's after everybody's made their pit stops. So
debris on the racetrack. So I should say that came after they made their pit stops.
Wow, what a tough break for Thomas Scheckter, though. He lost two laps in there with all that monkey motion going on.
Well, see, one of the crew members was hit when he came in.
Yep, they're tending to him right now.
Let's take a look at what happened, Larry, when Thomas Scheckter made his pit stop. You're on board. All right, now.
Somebody, it looked like he ran over a tire back there. There you can see the crew member down there. That he ran over his leg.
I'd like to see that again, if at all possible.
He had some...
Oh, here it comes again.
Let's take a look down here as he goes in.
He got his,
they told Takagi to go out. And Takagi pulled right out into him. You know, it's their responsibility to watch for the cars coming in. Takagi pulled right out, ran right into the left rear. Absolutely nothing that Scheckter did wrong. You can see the crew members in a lot of pain there. He got his leg run into pretty good. Got pinned between the wall and the
race
tire.
Car. Yeah.
So that's not a good.
And again, we talked earlier in the broadcast, Larry, about all the situations that Thomas Scheckter has been in that were of no fault of his. And then once again today, he's in the wrong spot at the wrong time. So it puts him really out of contention to this afternoon.
He's under our first caution for debris at the moment, but I think what most people at home want to see again is the mess that we got ourselves into at trackside in pit lane. First of all, we can see Scheckter coming in, and then a bit of rear wheel steering there. None of his fault as far as any of our studio pundits here are concerned, because Tora Takagi was released. The Mo Nun Racing team released Tora Takagi right in to the rear end of the pitting, and that's confirmed there, I think. With me are, of course, Paul Cherry and Johnny Molum, and I think Paul Cherry, a massive, and I can use this word I think now, cock up by Mo Nunn's team. They're allowing their car straight into the rear end.
Yeah, and that was totally uncalled for. The wheelman there really, you know, I don't know what he was thinking about. Poor old Thomas, he had nowhere to go. Poor pit crew. The downside is the pit crew just completely lost it, overreacted so badly. It was, as Johnny said, it was a fire drill of some sort.
Yes, indeed. Well, Tora Takagi, of course, wouldn't have known either. He has to rely, Johnny, on his pit crew to tell him to move out of pit lane, of course. It was just a mess for everybody.
Yeah, I mean, you're completely in the cockpit. You can't see anything coming. You're angled, so you can't even look down the pit lane to see what's coming in. And he just moved forward, started going, went about a foot, and then the next thing, he's got Thomas coming across his nose and his guy's telling him to stop, but he'd already told him to go and he'd moved. So, to be fair to him, it's not his fault either.
Well, we're on board now live with Thomas Scheckter. We're still under a caution period at the moment. Thomas Scheckter, well, his luck just doesn't work. If he had any luck this year, it would, of course, be bad.
These are close quarters here in the pits, and it looked to me like the 12 car's crew chief just sent the 12 car. I don't think it was Torres' fault, but I think his crew chief needs to watch what he's doing. It's clearly their fault. Ran into Thomas, who was in front of him when he let him out, so I don't know what else you do other than we just get the car going, we're lapped down, we still think we have a chance of winning this thing.
You had damage to the car, but you also had a crew man down. What was his name?
His name was Steve Namasnack. We call him Snack. It was some kind of leg injury, we don't know what yet. But again, if crew chief on the 12 car had been paying attention, we wouldn't be here right now.
Well, guys, the good news, number 4 car is back out on the track.
Doug Bowles, one of the co-owners of this racing operation, and it's exactly what you said, Larry.
Yeah.
I mean, he hit it right on the button.
I think he's exactly right. I think it's the crew chief's fault. The guy who's on the right front, the guy who was responsible for sending Takagi out, he messed up big time. That was a huge, huge mistake. And if somebody had done it to him, he'd be just as mad as Doug Bowles is. And I don't blame him one bit. I'd be yelling and screaming at the officials and everybody else And I'd be looking for something to be done to that guy, because that was a dumb, dumb mistake.
Well, Elio now will restart in seventh position after starting the race in 20th. And this is a very lengthy. Here's Scheckter back in the pit area under this yellow. Very lengthy yellow stop.
Good strategic move right here. Get more fuel. Try to outlast. Try to stay out there and get your lap back on fuel strategy and pit strategy. This is a very, very smart move on their part, because now they can stay out for two or three or four laps longer. If the yellow comes out, they're right back in the hunt. That's the kind of thing you have to do. You have to take some chances like that. You got nothing to lose. You're clearing the back of the pack anyway.
So you're a lap off the pace.
Yeah, you're a lap off the pace and in the back. So you have to use some other kind of strategy to try to get back up front. You heard Doug Bowles say he still thinks they have a chance to win the race, and it's going to be hard, but it can be done.
Well, once again, you see that SSR, that custom Chevrolet pickup truck, still on the racetrack. So, Larry, a very lengthy yellow for debris. We've been under yellow now for the past five laps.
And
there is
go.
The furl flag, so one lap, Ryan Howard will turn them loose the next time by.
And they'll be getting a little closer to the group. They've been kind of spread out all over the racetrack. Everybody will be catching up now, but it'll be interesting to see when this race starts. Two people, Mira and Scheckter. Mira back in ninth position. He's going to come back towards the front. You can bet on that. And Weldon, who was not running all that well, we'll see if he can hang on there to second place, because he had faded back to about eighth or ninth before the green flag.
But we've seen Weldon win in the past when he wasn't the fastest driver out there at Richmond.
And again, pit strategy. He started in 20th position, and it was pit strategy that paid off for him that time, too.
Well, the green will come out as they complete lap 45. There's Manning back in the third. A good ride for Darren. And right away, he pulls the high side, trying to get a good run on Weldon on the restart. And he does so. Look at him stack up to almost three wide.
Wow.
But look at Rice. We thought Manning was going to get a good restart. Look at Manning. He's dropped how many positions?
Well, he got out of the throttle. He started to pull out. Somebody was out there, and he had to pull back down. He got out of the throttle, and he did that.
Lost that sixth position.
He lost all of his momentum and went straight backwards. You're exactly right. Here comes Mira to the inside, going around Herta. Franchitti behind Herta. He's going to the inside, too.
So Tony Kanaan has led all 45 laps. Now we're hearing a report from race control, a rough-sounding engine in number 13, the Access Motorsports car of Mark Taylor. And there goes Scott Dixon on the inside of Franchitti.
Actually Darren Manning on the inside. But now then, look at this. Here comes Matt Sura back on the outside. He's three wide going in down here to turn number three.
You got a glimpse there of the number 17. Of Mira, no, it's 27 of Franchitti. A little glare there on the camera lens. There's Matsura. They're riding with first Franchitti, now Manning.
Well, you can see everybody kind of jockeying for position here early in this little go.
Kanaan leads Weldon. You see the interval now between first and second at the top of your screen. Hornish back and forth with Castroneves, Mira, Herta, and Fernandez. Fernandez now trying to work the high groove around Herta, and this is a battle for seventh position. Battle right back then behind them between Franchitti and Matsura. Franchitti with a nose up on Matsura. This is seventh Herta. Our number seven is Herta. He's in seventh position. Number five is Fernandez. He's in eighth.
Look at this battle up here. Rice to the outside of Dan Weldon. Right behind him, Hornish and Castroneves. All of them stacked up there. It looks like Weldon's holding that whole group up.
Weldon down the inside. Rice up on the high side. Right behind Rice are the two Penske cars of Hornish and Castroneves. Then Vito Mira.
First 14 cars, all just nose to tail there. What a huge group.
Top three are Hondas. Then you've got a pair of Toyotas back there in the Penske teammates.
You told Mira back there right behind them, and then Brian Herta in the yellow car. So
got a pair of Hondas sandwiched between, three Hondas in front, and there Two Toyotas there, sandwiched by three Hondas in front and three right behind them. You had that Chevy up there with Schechter for that pit accident.
Yeah. Haven't seen him come up quite as fast as we thought he might, but still, he's working his way through the group. He's trying to get around them and catch up with this lead pack.
Look at this battle for second, side by side. Look at this. Look at Vito Mira. Look at Caster Nevitz. He's gotten around Hornish for fourth, and here comes Vito Mira. They're stacked up side by side for second, side by side for fifth.
We knew that Caster Nevitz was not going to stay in the back of the pack for long after that very, very quick qualifying time. Look at Mira, though. He's really, we said he'd be one of the guys to watch after this green flag came out, and he has been.
He has been the most impressive driver, Larry, I think, of the mid part of the section. If you divide this season into three parts, the midsection, I think he's been the most spectacular.
Well, no doubt about it. He's been very, very strong, and he's been strong in every race that he's run since Indianapolis.
Well, they can get close to Kanaan, but they can't get around him. He has led from the opening green, led 51 laps, and look at this. He's almost pushing Rice.
Yeah, it looked like if they could do bump drafting in this kind of racing, it almost looked like that's what he wanted to do.
But they need some bigger bumpers.
Yeah, you don't dare want to do that in these Indy cars, but boy, he looked like he was so close. He just about touched Buddy Rice. Talking about Caster Nevitz.
Well, Weldon gets back in the fray. Where'd he come from?
Well, he's been in there all along. That's who they've been trying to get around. Weldon's been, he started this in second. He just now got past, and he's still kind of holding up this pack. So, Mira, Caster Nevitz both trying to get around Weldon.
And here comes Franchitti. There's that shot right there, but right behind the shot, just off the screen, is Franchitti. That's Mira on the high side, number 17.
And Hornish just blew him off. Just went around him.
And Hornish closes in on his teammate, Caster Nevitz. So this will be a battle for a fourth position as you're right along with Manning on lap 54. Tony Kanaan continues to lead as he has from the start over Rice, Weldon, Caster Nevitz, and Mira, riding back along with Manning right now. And that's Herta in front of him. Now Manning has dropped back to 12th position. Dixon now on the climb. He's back up to 10th. And look at this.
Hornish
to the inside of Weldon.
Weldon moved up the racetrack to block Caster Nevitz.
And Hornish said, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for leaving this lane open. I'll just take that.
And here comes Mira. Had a thought to go inside, but couldn't make the run down there. Didn't have the momentum. But look at the top five, the top six, right now less than a second between first and sixth. In fact, 0.8 of a second separating Kanaan and Mira, who's back in sixth position.
Yeah, you can see, looks like Caster Nevitz and Mira both want to run around the top of the racetrack. And here comes
Matsura gotten around Franchitti. So he's learning as he goes. You mentioned not having the experience on the drafting here at Michigan, but he's catching on.
Yes, he is, and he's doing a good job as he's caught back up with these guys after falling back a ways, and I think he's learning a little bit about the drafting situation here.
Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh, right there on your television screen. Working on lap 57, Kanaan leads it, but this is the battle for position as Masura goes around Mira for sixth position. Up in front, there's the gap, narrows down between first and second. We've had only one leader in this race, and that's been Kanaan. Buddy Rice looking to perhaps take that lead. Remember, there are three bonus points for leading the most laps, and right now, Kanaan's on his way to those points.
Yeah, he certainly is. Buddy Rice can pull up on him down the straightaways, uses that draft to pull up, but when he gets to the corner and he moves up that racetrack just that little bit to keep the downforce on the wings, Kanaan gains that one or two car lengths back, and it's just been kind of that way since the opening of the race. Nobody, they can catch him, they just can't get within about two car lengths of him, and he pulls away again.
A dark car you saw in front would be Mark Taylor in number 13. He's reported of having a miss in the engine of the Access Motorsports entry. Now it looks like Weldon is in that sandwich of the Marlboro Penske cars. That is a third, fourth, and fifth.
And you can see those guys, Castroneves, he's been trying to find a way to get around, but he can't get to the inside. It doesn't look like his car handles as well on the inside of the racetrack as maybe Hornish's does. Hornish can run in the bottom. Castroneves has stayed up around the top as most of the race today.
And there is Vito Mira. So right now on your screen, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. That's how close they are down the backstretch into the 18-degree banking of turn three.
We talked about not being, you know, how tough this was on drivers, and that's why it's tough on drivers. You've got to make a lot of decisions out there every lap. You've got to decide where to go, what to do without running into the guy in front of you when you're running with your foot flat to the floor, all the time knowing that if you lift just a little bit, you're going to go backwards. You're going to lose a couple of spots. Or in Darren Manning's case, on that restart, he lost about six or seven spots. So you really have to be careful. Look at this.
Look at this back and forth.
Darting around like that, that's part of it. Here comes Fernandez and Franchitti.
And here comes Darren Manning. But notice, as you said early on in the race, how they kind of stack up as they go in the corner.
Right.
Not single file. They get some air on the front wings, get some downforce.
You can do that here. You can run single file down the straightaways. When you get in those 18-degree corners, you've got to give some room. Franchitti tries to go to the bottom. He's been trying to go to the bottom and turn around Fernandez now for the last three or four laps. Just can't quite pull it off. But boy, when these guys are darting around down the straightaways like they are, it just seems inevitable that they're going to run into each other at some point, but they just don't ever seem to do that.
We've had one yellow so far. If you've just joined us this afternoon, live coverage from Michigan International Speedway, only one yellow. That was for Debris. It was about a seven-lap yellow, though, a lengthy yellow for Debris, back between laps 38 and 45. Vito Mira
makes his move. He's got around Weldon now that he's gotten around Hornish.
So Vito goes to third position and sets sail for his teammate, Buddy Rice, who rides in second.
Well, he's, as we've documented, he's been extremely fast here the last several races. Today is no different.
Should have won. He finished second twice. He probably should have won those races. He had some trouble in the pit area that cost him the victory.
Well, he had trouble in the pit area here today. That's the reason he was ninth on the restart. He was up front and has had to work his way back from ninth back up to third. And given the caliber of cars and the caliber of drivers and equipment, that's not an easy thing to do.
He's had to work harder than anybody else.
Yeah, exactly.
We will tell you that Scheckter has moved up a couple of positions. He's up to 19th right now, which is the first car on the lap off the base. Sharp is 18th, the last car on the lead lap. Vito Mira. He's had two second-place finishes so far this season, but right now back in third, he's 1.2 seconds behind these two drivers right here. That's the gap between first and second. Tony Kanaan and Buddy Rice.
And if you look at the back, when we get a long shot of the lead pack, you'll see that the last car in this lead pack is Thomas Scheckter. He's gotten around all those cars in the back, and he's caught up with this lead pack. Now then, his real goal is going to be to get back around these guys before the next yellow flag comes out. That's going to be a tall order.
You're watching the first two in the point standings run 1-2 here this afternoon. Tony Kanaan had a 64-point margin over Buddy Rice coming into this race, but he's going to probably secure those three bonus points for leading the most laps. He has led all 65 laps so far here this afternoon. Buddy Rice second, some 64 points back. Dan Weldon third, 81 back. Then Elio Castroneves and his teammate Sam Hornish. The top five drivers are separated by 122 points with this and six more races to go.
Yeah, all these guys up front all running between 211, 213 miles an hour. It just depends on the draft and what's happening in front of them on every lap. But all of them running very, very similar speeds lap after lap.
And guess who had the fastest lap last time?
I don't know. Thomas Scheckter
is the fastest driver on the racetrack. Now, that comes to no surprise for those of us that know him and how unhappy he must be in that cockpit. It comes as no surprise he's the fastest driver out there.
Well, there are 14 cars in this lead pack. He is the 14th car, even though he's a lap down. So he's hanging right with these guys. But, again, catching them and passing them, two different things.
So we can't hear from Ken Green at the Andretti Green Racing Organization. As his driver leads this race.
pace so far?
Well, so far the car's good. He really looked after his Firestone tyres in that last run. We probably could have run another 10 laps on tyres, didn't have enough fuel, but he's doing a great job. It's a long way to go. We want to be comfortable out front if we can. If somebody gets around us, we'll sit and follow and try and make better fuel, but so far everything's going well.
He's about to be double teamed by Ray Hall Letterman. Where's your help for him?
Well, we're hoping our teammates will come up. You know, it's a big ask, but we'd love a 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a tough series. There's so many good cars and a lot of good Hondas, obviously.
Give him green, guys.
Well, Kanaan talking about being double-teamed there by the Ray Hall Letterman team because he has Rice right behind him, and Vito Mirra is coming in third position. His closest teammate, meaning Kanaan, would be Weldon back in seventh, and Franchitti is 11th, and Herta is 13th.
Yeah, and again, you can see Buddy Rice. He can catch him, just can't get around him.
Well, so we're working on lap 70, and all the laps have been led so far by Tony Kanaan. Continues from Michigan International, the Michigan Indy 400. 200 laps in this high bank racetrack in the southern part of the state of Michigan. As you ride now with the Dixon back in eighth position, trying to get under there, the last lap, trying to get under Castro Nevis, but here comes Fernandez.
Yeah, look at Matsura. He's moved all the way back up to fourth after that terrible, terrible pit stop. I think he was back in like 12th position after the that first round of pit stops. So Matsura has done a good job too, coming back up through the pack, passing cars one at a time. He qualified third, quick, started second, but he's done a great job. He's learned very quickly about the draft here. And look at Fernandez. He got a great run that time.
Remember, Matsura was the first of the leaders to peel off to the pit stop. And they were setting up for his second stop.
Yeah, and here you can see, that's Thomas Schechter right behind Fernandez. So he's come up and, Matsura already back in the pit.
Yeah, he was the first to stop the last time. And so again, early stop for Matsura.
Yeah, that has not played into his favor, quite honestly. That was a good pit stop, though. These other guys will be coming in probably, they'll run another four or five laps, I would think, most of them.
Well, there's Toru Takagi now. They don't want to make a pit stop for the Panther team with him still.
No, they'll get knot speed on their head if they do that again.
Get him out of the way. That team basically has been a real disappointment this year.
Toru Takagi has been the biggest disappointment of any driver in this series this year. He's just, everybody thought he would win a race. He hasn't even been on the lead lap most of the year. I mean, he's been awful. So
and you have to say, Larry, when you say, you mentioned the driver, and it's the whole team effort.
The whole team
has been lousy this year.
The whole team, but, you know, he ran pretty good up till that race in Japan when he took that hard lick. And I don't know whether it is the driver. Nobody really knows whether it's the driver or the team effort. But whatever, the whole operation has not done very well this year.
Look at Mira.
Right in the hunt. Look at these guys all down there. Look at Schechter. You think he doesn't want that lap back? He just went by both of the Penske cars down the back straightaway. Wow, these guys are peeling off. If he could luck out now with the... he's up there. Look at all the guys heading for the pit area, though. Those guys were heading for the pits. I thought that was a little bit too much to ask for.
Yeah, but still, he can stay out there.
Yep, he can stay out another 3 or 4 laps beyond what these rest of them can.
Then if a yellow comes out.
Now let's see. Mira's the one who had a bad pit stop last time. Let's see if they do better this time.
There's Mira's pit.
He did.
Yep.
He got a much better pit stop. He beat both the Penske's cars out.
Here is Rice. He was riding in second position. That will move well into second. Manning to third. We'll wait for Kanaan. Remember, Kanaan maintained the lead through that first round of pit stops. He has led all 79 laps. Working on lap 80. There you see the pit stop time for Buddy Rice.
Very good pit stop.
Good stop.
Less than 9 seconds. That's very, very quick.
Well, they're leaving Kanaan as long as they can. Because obviously if a yellow came out now, he'd have a huge advantage.
Yeah, he would have a huge advantage.
Oh, look at this. This is a surprise.
Yeah, Scheckter came in a little quicker than we thought, but still.
We thought Scheckter would stay out until after Kanaan came in.
Uh-oh.
Well,
another miscue
there.
I wonder if he got all the fuel in there.
Now here comes Scheckter. There is Franchitti about to pull out. What a drag race Scheckter to the line.
Here comes Dan Weldon now, heading for the pit lane. There's still five or six cars out there that have not pitted.
Bell, Weldon, Manning. When are they going to bring Franchitti or when they're going to bring Kanaan in?
Weldon back out. He and Manning now have made their pit stops.
Here comes Kanaan. Let's see if his cycle through, he can maintain this lead, because obviously as the rest of them peeled off, he increased his lead. Kanaan was almost hit there coming in.
Carpenter pulled right out in front of him.
Quick stop, 8.5.
That's a terrific stop. Anytime you're under 9 seconds, you've done a good job. And here comes Buddy Rice, though.
See how quickly Kanaan can get back up to speed.
Interesting to see. Doesn't look like he's going to do it. Looks like somebody else might actually leave.
Oh, that was Torrey. That was Takagi. That looks like Kanaan's going to hang on. Looks like Kanaan's going to maintain that lead. How about that? With the two Rahal cars right behind him. Got by Takagi and Sharp. So right now your leaders are Kanaan, Rice, Mira, Matsura, then Weldon, Hornish, Dixon, Castroneves. So a real scramble for position on that second pit stop.
Yeah. Rice and Vito Mira both had good pit stops, but Kanaan had just as good a pit stop, and he maintained the lead. Hornish and Castroneves are the ones that did not have as good pit stops as you might have expected that time through.
Hornish now running in sixth position. Castroneves is eight. Here comes a shot of Scheckter again. Now, Scheckter tucked up behind Weldon there. And Hornish. And he pulls in the battle for fifth position. We'll see what he can do with 84 sprint laps now complete. But Tony Kanaan gained his first pole position of the season and has led from the opening green through two pit stops and now has led 85 circuits. You're riding along with Thomas Scheckter, who actually is back in 19th position, a full lap off the pace. And he's tucked in behind Hornish. Hornish and Weldon battling for fifth position.
Yeah, he's trying to get back around those guys so that he can get back on the lead lap. Very, very hard to get back up there. He's passed a lot of cars. Boy, he's still got a lot of good cars to pass to get up there and get on that lead lap.
Well, we had surmised that he might stay out two or three laps past the leader. Didn't happen, but really wouldn't have mattered because he didn't pick up that yellow that he needed anyway.
Didn't pick up the yellow, so it didn't really matter. He didn't want to take a chance on running out of fuel. We don't really know what kind of fuel mileage this new Chevrolet is getting. But I think they just didn't want to take a chance. Remember, they ran him out of fuel one time this year, and it cost him a race, so they don't want to do that again. I shouldn't say cost him a race.
He's still running laps at 214, so one of the fastest three or four drivers on the racetrack here this afternoon. So Kanaan continues to lead over Rice and Mira.
Well, we obviously apologise for the loss of transmission from the States at the moment. This is live, of course, the Michigan 400. You join us back here in the studio while we sort ourselves out with the feed. Paul Cherry and Johnny Molam are with us, of course. We will take a look at the pictures while we talk over this at the moment. Canaan Rice, Mira Matsura and Weldon with Hornish on the back there. But well, you have to say that Thomas Scheckter, all eyes are on at the moment, Paul.
Yes, he is the fastest man on the track every lap. Quite wisely, even though the situation would have probably suited him to stay out a bit longer, he decided to come in and take fuel. As the commentators said, the team had actually run him out, if you remember, at Richmond, so they probably don't want to do that. However, they're going to obviously look for some strategy for the second half of this race.
From the British point of view, Johnny, very quickly, Danny Weldon out there still hanging right in with them.
Yeah, he's doing very well, actually. He's not actually got that particularly a quick car, I don't think, at the moment. I mean, that might change later on in the race, but he's managed to keep himself right up there, and that's all that matters.
Tony Canaan, though, the series leader, has led this race from the green flag. He's still out in front right now. Let's go back to the track then and our live commentators at trackside.
Scheckter and Sharp are both a lap off the pace, so when he goes by Sharp, he's going to move from 19th to 18th position. He's going by Sharp right there. And here comes Matsura.
That's not really the thing that he's concerned about. Because he knows he's been faster than Sharp all day long. And as we talked about...
He's been faster than most of these guys all day long.
Yeah, and as we talked about some of the disappointments this year, I think Scott Sharp is another one that's been a huge disappointment this year. Has not really been in the race, in any of the races so far.
There was some question about the future of Kelly Racing. There was an announcement made this season about a month ago that they had financial backing and sponsorship through the end of next year.
Yeah, but
they simply have not been competitive. This will be the first year in probably eight seasons that, Sharp has not won at least one race.
Yeah, they've really had a tough season as we watch. We're going to take a look at this pit accident once again. You can see he got tagged in the left rear, turned the car right into the pit wall, and that crew member's...
We understand from the infield care center that there is nothing broken and he is being transferred to the local hospital in Coldwater for observation.
Well, yeah, very, that's very lucky. He could have pulled some ligaments or muscles or whatever, because he did get pinned between the wall and that left front tire. Again, no, absolutely no fault of the Panther team or Thomas Scheckter. That was strictly the fault of the crew chief or the head guy. Whoever motioned toward Takagi out of the pit area just was not paying attention to what was happening on the racetrack.
So look at...
That's Alex Barron.
Last year's winner here.
Yes, he's has not been as strong here today as he would like. They came in here with some very, very high hopes, but he's not been quite as strong today as they thought they might be.
In
the
14th position right now, driving for the Red Bull Team Cheever organization.
Right. Townsend Bell and Thomas Scheckter have been by far the strongest two Chevrolets here. Chevrolet working very hard on those engines, trying to get them more horsepower, but the rest of the Chevrolet guys struggling a little bit, especially Team Cheever with Barron and Carpenter.
Well, Bell is the best Chevrolet today, back in 10th position. He's some 7.8 seconds behind the leader. Barron back in the 14th spot. Giafone has a Chevrolet back in 16th. Carpenter is 17th of the Chevy. 18th is Scheckter, and he is a lap down, but Scheckter by far the fastest Chevrolet here this afternoon.
These three guys right now are walking away from everybody else. These three cars running nose to tail are about 4 seconds ahead of everybody else on the racetrack. And as Kim Green said a while ago, or they asked him what he thought about getting teamed up on or ganged up on, so far, the two of them haven't been able to pull anything off. They haven't been able to use that draft to their advantage because Tony Canaan is standing right on the bottom of the racetrack. He's using the fastest way around or the shortest way around, and they just haven't had the speed to go around him on the outside.
Larry, there's some traffic coming up. They may play the traffic card.
Well, that's what they're going to have to do. But they need to get close enough to force him one way or the other. So far, they've still been like the car length back, and he can really go any place he wants to go.
That's Lazier.
He's going to have to go to the outside here. I'm sure he didn't want to do that, but Lazier was right on the bottom. Didn't give him any choice.
Lazier and Carpenter.
Lee Carpenter in the blue and yellow car. Now let's see what happens if Buddy Wright has any way or any place he can go to get around it.
Then they're going to have the Purex number 24 of Giafone, then the 14 of Foyt.
Kanaan has just done an absolutely superb job. He has not made a miscue. He's not done anything wrong. And as long as he keeps running like this, it's going to be very, very difficult to get around him.
Well, it's going to be difficult to get around him today or get ready for the championship.
Right.
He has
right.
done everything he has to do to win a championship. He's now led 97 laps, so I think it's probably safe to give him those additional 3 bonus points for leading those laps.
Look at the crowd. A huge, huge crowd up here in Michigan.
They're going by Giafone in the 24 car. That's the car that's owned in part by Robbie Buell, who stepped out of the ride as a driver just before this year's Indianapolis 500. Now they go to the low side of A.J. Foyt. Foyt back in the 15th position. And A.J. is out there doing exactly what his grandpa wants. Keep your nose clean, kid, and get some experience.
Yep. Get some laps. Do what you do. You know, learn what you can. Learn about the draft. Kanaan actually got through the traffic better than Mir or Rice, either one. He just sliced through them, went on around, and he's gained 5 or 6 car lengths while they've been in the traffic. So that's a pretty good indication of what a great day he's had.
Halfway coming up this time, they'll complete 100 of the 200 scheduled laps. Let's look at AJ. Second place is Rice, third place is Mira. And they'll complete 100 laps this time by.
Well, once again, we apologize for the loss of pictures, of course, but joining us here still, or should I say staying with us here still, are Paul Cherry and Johnny Mallam. And we were just talking about some of the stunts that we see around the world during the course of the year. But at the moment, the stunt that I think we can all be impressed with, Tony Kanaan, he picks up his 3 points for leading this race right from the start. And another little stat for those of you at home that are paying attention, he has actually covered every single lap that this year's IRL has covered. He's the only driver to have covered every single lap. Consistency pays off, Paul.
That's why he's 64 points in the lead. However, if he has a DNF, he could lose that instantly, because Weldon and Rice, who are behind him in the points league, they're right behind him in the race. So he needs to... He's comfortably out front, but he does not want to have a DNF at any point now.
So Tony Kanaan leads the Michigan 400. We will be live with them again in just a few minutes, but right now...
He has passed everybody else. He's come from dead last, passed all the Cornish, Weldon, Dixon, Castroneves, the whole bunch of them, and now he's gaining ever so slightly on our 3 leaders. If he could catch them and pass them, which I don't think is going to be an easy task. I'm not sure he can do it, but if he could... Uh-oh, here he comes in the pits.
Coming in the pits. This is an unscheduled pit stop for Thomas Schechter.
Yeah, doesn't look good.
I was about to say he'd be asking himself, what if he stayed out there and ran the distance, but an unscheduled pit stop for Thomas here in lap 108.
Yeah, tough break. You can see it looks like they're just going through the motions of changing tires and whatever. Maybe this is a strategic move, too. He may have done this hoping that he can stay out there the next time they come in and get on the lead lap.
Yeah, but is he going to be 2 laps off the pace now?
Well, I don't know. That's the question.
He could lose another lap on this green flag pit stop.
Well, it is, it's a strategy game. You got to do something. Like we said, it's going to be almost impossible for him to come up there and pass all these guys. So maybe he's using a little strategy, trying to get a break on some sort of a pit stop. And maybe it'll work for him.
Are you watching the lead 3 cars right now? On lap 109, they complete that lap. They go to 110. So they got to make, 1 more pit stop?
Well, at least
maybe
one
2.
More. Yeah, I think they're going to have to make 2 more pit stops. They're probably going to have to make 2 more pit stops to make it to the end.
And we have a yellow flag on the racetrack. Another yellow for debris, the second of the afternoon.
Well, let's see how this plays out. Well, Schechter's 2 laps down, so he's not going to get the lap back.
It won't really matter now that they're making a pit stop under yellow.
No.
Although it's been only 27 laps since the leader's pit stop.
Yeah, they made a choice, and obviously it turned out not to be a good one, but that's the sort of thing you have to do. You have to do something out of the ordinary to try to get back on the lead lap. I think you're going to see most of these guys come in and make pit stops now, though. But they're still short. I don't think there's anybody here, even if they make a pit stop under this yellow, that can go the race on one more pit stop.
No, because they'd have to go.
They'd have to go 45 laps, two different segments of 45 laps, and I don't know that they can do that. Although Kanaan's been getting better fuel mileage than anybody else, he's been running about 43 or 44 laps. Still, to stretch it to 45 is going to be a huge task. Again, it would depend on how many yellow flag laps they had there in those last 80 laps, too, 90 laps.
We've only had two yellows this afternoon, Larry, both for debris on the racetrack. The first, though, was a seven-lap yellow.
Here comes everybody in the pit area.
Now, Kanaan has led every lap in this event. He's led 110 circuits. He will lead 111 as he crosses the extension of the start-finish line there in the pit area. And think why they can't get him in and back out in the lead.
Now, this is going to be an important pit stop, though. The pits are very crowded. Everybody's in there. Everybody's going to be pulling in and pulling out at the same time. So you don't want to make a mistake. You don't want your crews to make a mistake. As you can see, everybody out there almost contact back there in the back, but Kanaan beat everybody out of the pits again.
Well, of course, he had that last pit stall down there. Gives him a clear pit when he leaves.
Gives him an advantage. There's no question about it. Absolutely right.
And that pit position, does that not go by points?
Yes, I think it does. Up in the points, the first point gets his first choice, I believe.
Okay, there's the pit exit. You can see those that went up or down. But still, Tony Kanaan stays out in front. Rice is second. Looks like there's the pit out. There was Kanaan. Okay, there's
Hornish almost got into second. He almost beat Rice out.
Then Hornish, then Mira.
Yeah. Hornish had a very, very good pit stop. He almost got into second place.
One of the traditions up here at Michigan, a big infield in these big super speedways with lots of areas to park your motorhomes, buses, converted school buses with platforms on top of them.
And with 18-degree banking, you can see the whole racetrack. That's very good for them.
Back on board with Franchitti, who will restart back in the eighth position with 112 laps now complete, working on lap 113 under yellow, a 200-lap scheduled event here in Michigan. 114 this time by with Kanaan, Rice, Hornish, Mira, Weldon, Dixon. The restart order here. Our second yellow of the afternoon, once again, for debris. We've been yellow now for four laps. Kanaan again made a pit stop, got in, got back out, and maintained the lead.
Yeah, the real critical thing is going to be whether there is another yellow flag in this race. If there is not another yellow flag, the guy who plays it safe and conserves fuel here is going to have a huge advantage and probably could win. But you don't know that. If there's another yellow flag, then everything is out the window and you could be way behind. So
we can't tell you that that Schechter pit strategy didn't really work. He lost a lap but then gained it back. So Schechter is still a lap off the pace back in now 19th position. Right. Look at Scott Dixon, his best start of the year in third. He's right now in sixth position.
He's had a pretty good run. It's not been a great run, but he's had a pretty good run here today.
There's a look at Elio Castroneves, who started in 20th position. We documented the fact they changed the engine after qualifying yesterday. There's A.J. Foyt. A.J. is a lap off the pace back in 16th position as we go back to green flag racing.
Oh, and look at this. Buddy Rice feeling his oats, goes to the outside. Hornish on the outside of him. They're going to go into turn one. Looks like Buddy Rice actually is inched ahead.
Buddy Rice is the second leader this afternoon, but remember, they only count the leader as he crosses the finish line. The start-finish line denotes who actually leads this lap. So although Buddy Rice has a nose up right now,
I don't think he's going to lead at the finish line.
It's going to be Tony Kanaan from that inside group who will maintain that lead. So
Mira goes out there to try to help him, but Tony Kanaan he did what he's done all day long. He's kept it right on that white line, right around the inside, the shortest way around the racetrack, and he makes it very difficult for anybody to make that pass. Dan Weldon.
Look how high Weldon is on the racetrack.
Trying to go around the outside of Vito Mira.
Only had two yellows this afternoon, both for debris. The first was a 7-lap yellow. His fast yellow was 5 laps. Gave the guys a chance to make that pit stop. Kanaan continues to lead us at all 116 circuits here at Michigan. Rice is second, Hornish is third, then Mira. Mira had been challenging Hornish for third. Now he falls off the pace just a bit.
Yeah.
There's Weldon back in fifth.
That's what makes this racetrack so interesting. You know, if you just slip a little bit, you lose a draft a little bit, you can fall back. Now he fell back. Now he's coming back to challenge his teammate for second place.
Gets back around Hornish, stays on the high side, maintains the momentum.
He's run the high side all day long. He's not moved down. Even in lap traffic, he did not move to the bottom of the racetrack to try to get around anybody. He's run that high groove and tried to make it work. It has most of the day, but it has not on certain occasions as well.
There is Weldon and Casper Nevitz, and then Franchitti all together on the racetrack.
But you can see it's like a snake going down that back straightaway. They all want to get right to the bottom of the racetrack and in behind the guy in front of them so they can get that toe, that little draft down the straightaway.
119 laps about to be completed. And right now, between first and eighth, it's less than a second.
Oh, yeah, these guys are all, look at that, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11, 12 cars right there in that lead group.
Well, Tony Kanaan has won the most races. He's won 3 this season. He's led the most laps. But coming in to this event, he's got 474 laps, so add to that 120 right now.
Well, Weldon's feeling his oats. He's run pretty strong, and he moved to the outside trying to make a pass. Hasn't been able to do it yet. Now that he's got Dixon down on the bottom side going around him.
I wonder if his helmet fits differently now that he shaved his hair off.
I don't know.
He needs a smaller helmet.
Castro Nevis has come on. Is he going around Weldon, too? So Castro Nevis, his teammate Hornish, both right up there amongst them.
So Andretti Green leads this thing. Ray Hall Letterman riding second and third, and Team Penske fourth and fifth.
Castro Nevis looks like he wants to make a move on his teammate. Tries to go to the outside. He's kind of like Mira has been with Buddy Rice, trying to get around him, just hasn't been able to do it for the last, since that pit stop.
And this is the best race for Scott Dixon in a long time. He's back there in sixth position. There's Manning. Manning is back in eighth. He's right along with Darren right now.
Yeah, Scott Dixon has been right amongst the, he's been in the hunt. That's the main thing. He's been with the lead pack. And look at this. Mira gets up beside him. Fell back. Couldn't do it.
And then on the inside comes Hornish.
Yeah, Hornish got a good run. Now he's to the inside of Mira. Castro Nevis
tucked him behind Mira, but the Penske cars are side by side.
But they're moving all over the racetrack. This is really a game of chess for these drivers, trying to figure out and trying different places on. Oh,
that was close.
Man, oh man.
There's something flopping on the front of Castro Nevis.
Castro Nevis, I think he had trouble. I think when he came down,
there was some contact between Mira and.
Yellow flag is out. I think there was some contact. Oh, Franchitti.
Oh, Franchitti. On lap 124.
He's pulled in. Looks like he's had engine trouble and pulled into the pit, but he didn't get far enough off, so they threw the yellow flag.
He's quick to walk away. Not sure what that signal was.
Yeah, I don't either.
Maybe he's got a hot rump from blown engine, perhaps.
Let's take a look here at Mira, see if we can see anything on his car. Oh, he's got a flat left rear tire from the contact. He's got a flat left rear tire. He's going to head in because when he made contact with Castro Nevis, that was the result.
Fortunately, he's going to make this stop under yellow. once they open. Now watch again. Watch the contact.
Castroneves just, he made a move to the inside. And right there, he hit the wing. Oh, the wing, I bet you that's the reason for the yellow. There's debris from that wing. So Castroneves is going to have to come in, replace the wing, and Mira's going to have to come in and make some left rear.
Here's Franchitti. Whoa! That was close for Manning. Franchitti lost the power plant in his Honda, and Manning almost collected him. Well, what do we have there? That's a piece of the wing.
Up in the fence.
He said Elio's wing up in the catch fence.
And that's,
they got to climb up there and get that?
And that's the reason they put those catch fences up there, so that it doesn't get into the crowd. So that was
so the yellow remains out on lap 125. In a fortunate situation under the yellow, those guys can come in and make those necessary repairs here in Michigan.
This was the reason why Vita Mira and Castroneves just coming together very slightly there on the track. No fault that we can ascertain between either driver here in the studio at Sky Sports. But obviously the yellow was brought out for the debris that came across. And we can take another look at this as we're on board now with Darren Manning, who just about manages to miss the rear end of the blown Dario Franchitti. Franchitti was the man on the right-hand side. Excuse me while I find you back here on the camera. Gentlemen, very quickly, it's all happening in the last few minutes. Firstly, though, let's cover the Castroneves Vitor Mira situation. If I can come to you first, Johnny, on this, because you're a driver in this set of circumstances. Any fault to any one of the two drivers?
Well, initially I actually thought it was Mira's fault because it looked like he just pinched in. But then when you watch it on the replay, it looked like Castroneves actually darted down the inside and Mira has to come in slightly there anyway and didn't even realise he was there. So probably Castroneves, not really any fault, but he laid himself open for that happening and unfortunate that it's cost them both a situation where they're not going to do maybe so well in the race.
Of course, yellow flag out. Dario Franchitti, we know Paul's got a blown engine. We saw that graphically. He's out of the car. Everything perfectly okay, but a disaster for him at this point.
Yeah, I mean, it's not doing his chances any good of a reasonable place in the championship. However, he's the same team and it's a Honda engine, so I'm sure Andretti Green are all in the timing stand with their fingers crossed now.
Well, I can tell you, if Dario Franchitti has seen it all happen down in pit lane, an opportunity was there for him to move up the order, because this is what happened when we went to a break in pit lane. An almighty shenanigans right in the middle of pit lane. Vita Mira, who was a front runner along with Adrian Fernandez, get themselves all stuck in the middle of the pits. And Paul, what's all this about?
This is all about misreading your pit signal as to where you should pit. These guys have been doing it for 3 days. And quite clearly, they're still, in the heat of the moment, undecided as to where they're going to stop. And unfortunately, you get a little bit of a melee like that.
Well, I can tell you that we will be having a better angle on that, so we'll give you guys half a chance to actually put a slightly more comprehensive viewpoint on it. But it does seem to me a lot of anxiety in pit lane, Johnny, I think, this week. I mean, this is a major race, obviously. It's at the time of the season when things really do count. Contracts are floating around at this moment in time. Are we seeing some of that anxiety translated into what's happening here?
Maybe it's because I'm a driver, but I actually personally think a lot of it is actually down to the teams themselves. I mean, it's so critical and there's so much responsibility and pressure on the person allowing the cars in and out. So, I mean, you're there and you think you can just sneak through. You know you can gain maybe one or two places, track position. And it's very, very critical to really get as slick a pit stop as you can. And I think that's why cars coming in, coming out, is always going to be asking for trouble in terms of contact. There's nothing you can do to avoid it.
Well, I'm glad you said all of that, because I think you're absolutely bang on dead right. But it's better coming from a driver than it is, obviously, from somebody like me. But let's have another look at it now. I mean, obviously, the schedule here, and you can... Oh, dear me. Deary me. Well, I mean, I think that's graphic. Paul, your comment?
It's just the same as the Schechter accident. The pit crews are not watching their car and they're not watching the gap in the pit lane to let them out.
Although, in fairness, you have to say that in that set of circumstances there, they're coming in quite quickly. The driver had been let out, but the guy coming across the other side should have seen it coming, really.
Well,
Johnny,
they let Adrian out quite a long time before Victor Mira arrived, and so basically when he was coming out, he was clear, and at the point he's coming out at an angle, Victor Mira, that he won't be able to see the guy coming in the mirrors. So basically in that situation, I don't really know what they can do to avoid that. It's actually the person coming in perhaps should have braked harder, but he can't see either, so
Tough decision. Pit crew certainly are going to be paying the penalty here at the moment, because pit crews are getting their ankles chopped out from under them left, right and centre. Paul, very quickly.
Well, I just think what Johnny says is probably right. It does also look that Adrian doesn't make such a good getaway out of there. He definitely didn't start off with a blaze of tyres, and then it suddenly went, and that's where he's hit hit Vitor, but, you know...
And is that Weldon's car that they've clouted as well there?
They've just pushed his back.
But I wonder whether it caught his wing. That was a snag that...
Hopefully not.
Certainly it was close to damaging Weldon's wing, which you know, it's critical for Danny Weldon. He's right on the pace here. He's right on the leaderboard, yeah. And a damaged wing would not go down well. Well, we're looking at the damaged wing of a pit crew. Nice socks, sir. Let's go back then live to trackside with our commentators.
They finally mandated helmets in there, and that saved both those guys. Are lucky they had helmets on anyway.
Let's see if we can't hear from Mike. There's the pace vehicle pulls off.
I saw him coming. I knew he was going to be in right behind us, but I had no idea he was going to come in quite that aggressively.
And then you got a little Mike Tyson punch in there for good measure.
I got to apologize to those guys. That was just purely anger right there. I didn't know if my foot was going to come with me when I got up, and I was scared.
Mike, we're glad you're okay. Good luck the rest of the way. Let's send it over to Doc Puck.
I think there was an engine problem, not sure. It was getting slower and slower, and that was it, really. Unfortunately, our KX car was pretty good, and we're making some ground up that last restart, but wasn't to be today. Pretty disappointed.
Dario Franchitti, last week's winner.
Let's see what Scheckter can do now on this restart.
Oops, he's not getting a good restart.
No, not at all.
There goes Kanaan and
Kanaan.
Both those guys got around him. That's the two guys he didn't want to get around him. He got around Manning first. He might have had a chance, but boy, with those two guys out there in front of him, it's going to be a difficult thing to do to get back in front of those two guys.
And so Kanaan's going to be back up where we've anticipated seeing him this season.
Yep. Too bad he's just a lap down. And here comes... Here's a close racing.
That's there between Weldon.
Weldon and Dixon running very, very close to each other. You can see what a gaggle of cars there is back there behind him. Is everybody very close on these restarts.
So Kanaan's only been out of lead for about 10 laps. 132 contested this afternoon.
And here comes Buddy Rice. His strategy, I understand Manning's strategy. He stayed out there to try to, you know, gain track position. I don't understand why Buddy Rice stayed out there and then came in right at the very end. It makes no sense to me, but, oh, man, he's flying. He goes around the outside of Mira, and Mira's been one of the fastest guys on the racetrack all day long.
Well, Rice is back in 11th position. Now, keep in mind that 2 years ago, Scheckter won this thing when he was 12th. With 20 laps to go, he was in 12th position, still won it.
Well, anything can happen here at Michigan. This is a heck of a racetrack. Very, very difficult. And Thomas Scheckter tried to pull it off there, tried to go around Castroneves, didn't make it. Hurt him now, showing a little muscle as he's on the outside, and Kanaan's just pulling away from everybody.
But now in third position, Hornish is second. Kanaan continues to lead. You're on board with Scheckter. He is a lap off the pace right now in 14th position. He is the number one driver on the lap down, if you will. Only 13 drivers on the lead lap. Fernandez was able to remain on the lead lap because that altercation with Fitz happened during the yellow. And so he was able to come back in, change the front nose piece, the front wing, and stay on the lead lap. He is now in 13th spot.
Kanaan has just pulled away from everybody. These guys all battling back here trying to...
One of their runs side by side, Kanaan's going to pull away.
Exactly, exactly. And you can't blame Scheckter. The only chance he's got after that miscue is to try to get around the leaders, get back on the lead lap, hope for a yellow flag. And, you know, he's doing what he has to do.
Right there on the outside of Cornish, and right behind is Castroneves, and then Weldon.
Yeah, Castroneves actually giving a little push to Scheckter right here.
Oh,
and
now
he gets around him.
Stack. Oh, almost contact between the two Penske cars.
Weldon goes around both of those guys. No, he doesn't. He had a run on him, but he didn't make it.
Got around him. Now can Scheckter run down? This is interesting. This will be interesting. Can Scheckter and the Chevy run down the Honda?
Well, if Scheckter runs down Tony Kanaan and passes him, whether he wins the race or not, Chevrolet is going to be
cheering.
They are going to be cheering him out.
That's right. That might be enough to have them sign on for next season.
You just saw Dan Weldon give a little wave right there saying, hey,
was Manning who went by.
Yeah.
And he's got Dixon right behind him. Sandwich there. And that's 15. That's Rice. Rice is all the way back to sixth position. Restart 15.
Well, he's got his act together here today. He's running well, I still don't understand that pit strategy. It didn't make any sense to me.
Well, that was 137 laps complete. Kanaan is back out on the point. Ornish is second, then Castro Nevis, then Weldon, Manning, Rice. Kanaan continues to lead, but now it is getting interesting because you're right with Schechter. Schechter's a lap off the pace. You look back at Ornish and Castro Nevis, and Rice stacked up there almost three wide. And look at this. They have caught Kanaan. The Chevy has caught the Honda. Now, will Kanaan let him go by or make him stay back there?
Well, he's not going to let him go by. Tony Kanaan has not been passed on the racetrack all day long, and he's not going to start with Thomas Schechter if he can keep him from it, because he knows if Thomas Schechter is strong enough to blow past him and get back on the lead lap and a yellow flag comes out, then he could be strong enough to come back and beat him near the end of the race. Remember, Thomas Schechter, we've talked about it several times. He was in 12th position with 20 to go and beat everybody. And look at this. He looks really strong. He's going to be the first guy all day to blow him by.
Chevrolet ate their Wheaties this morning.
Man, did they ever.
Still side by side. He still is not going to let him go by. He still wants to keep him a lap down because, as you say, a yellow, and Schechter be back in this thing. And look at Rice. Here comes Rice.
Rice is coming around here.
Rice is going to go with the high side of Schechter. Everybody rises to their feet.
Oh, man, Schechter.
And Penske cars are now side by side. They were side by side.
Yeah, Schechter kind of got boxed in there for just a second. Now then we'll see. He may get boxed in there and not get his
chance.
Somebody
behind him, not to the side of him, to make this work.
Yeah.
Now maybe.
See how much ground they lost when they get the battle in each other, how much ground they lost to Kanaan?
They need to get back in file, in single file, and pull back up on Kanaan.
Look at Hornish.
145 laps now complete.
Boy, just that little bit of draft, that little bit of air can slow you down that much. You get out of the draft, it's just amazing. I'm sure you followed a big truck down the highway and you pulled out from behind him out into the other lane. That big rush of air hits you. That's exactly what happens in these cars. And it can really hit that wind, that air, when it's not being cut through for you. You're not using the draft. It really slows you down. Here he goes again. He's going to give him another try.
Right now, Kanaan has led all but six laps this afternoon. Even if he gets past here, he'll still be the leader because that yellow car is a lap off the pace in 14th position. There's Mira.
Mira's
back in 13th position now.
Yeah, he's way off the pace. That obviously he has some suspension trouble. He bent something during that crash there in the pits. So a tough break for him. He had a terrific run going, but he's just not on the mark right now. But look at Thomas Schechter.
Ornish needs to get up there and kind of push Schechter by him.
Schechter is the first guy all day long that's been able to pull up beside Tony Kanaan and race with him.
And right. Maybe pass him.
And maybe pass him, right. There's been nobody else on the racetrack that's been able to pass him all day long.
It's just a matter of flat out right now. They are flat-footed all the way around the racetrack. Now look, they're stacked up two wide behind him as well.
Yep, here comes Buddy Rice.
Buddy Rice going to push him on by.
He's going to try to. He's going to try. Now that he moves to the outside, he may try to go around both of them.
So a lap car in the middle. They are three wide on lap 149.
Well, he got a big boost down that back straightaway, or front straightaway. Looks like he's going to pull this off. Maybe not.
Well, Schechter's not going anywhere.
Kanaan just cannot
can't be passed right now.
He just can't be passed. They just won't give up. They just can't. You get that big draft, you pull out, you get that one car length run down the front straightaway, but you can't get enough to go on by him.
Now, you know what it's like on the interstate when you're driving 70 miles an hour. Now, triple that.
Yeah. triple that and have guys weaving in and out. You've all had those guys that weaving in and out in the traffic trying to get around people. Well, look at this traffic.
They're working on lap 150. So three-fourths of the race complete this time by. And it's been all Tony Kanaan. With the exception of six laps, he has led this event from the pole position. Going for his fourth win this year. That's Manning. Manning back in seventh position.
Look at all the cars right in front of him. All those guys on the lead lap except Schechter.
And Schechter is a lap off the pace, back in 14th position. And he's been up there running side by side with Kanaan, but simply cannot get by him.
You see Manning's finishing position. Three top five finishes, fourth
being
the best.
His teammate, as Dixon just went by Manning for position. So Dixon goes to seventh. Manning drops to eighth.
Well, those two guys have been kind of racing each other all day long, really. Now Hornish is going to, he tried to go to the inside of Schechter, but can't do it. I'm sure those guys are saying, Schechter, get the heck out of the way. We want to race for the lead, but... I don't blame Thomas Schechter. He's racing to get back in the lead, on the lead lap.
He needs those guys to stack up single file behind him and help push him on by. They can really help each other. They get side by side like this, they're not helping each other.
Here comes Weldon.
Weldon back there in sixth position.
Look at Fernandez. Got a huge draft on those guys.
Yeah, where'd he come from?
Well, he's been running back there, but he... See, what happens is you get by them, almost get by them, and then you kind of fall back. But right there, Weldon let him go.
And look at Matsura. Matsura now is up to second position.
Wow.
This could be his day for a really good ride. I don't think it's going to be his day to win, but maybe he'll go up there and help Schechter.
Wow, I hadn't been paying much attention to Matsura, but you're right. He came... You got around Castroneves and Hornish and a whole bunch of them right there. And Rice, pretty strong contenders.
Now, Schechter needs some help. Schechter needs somebody to stick up in behind him and help push him on by Kanaan to get his lap back. But the laps are dwindling down. 46 laps to go as they cross the start-finish line.
Well, and Schechter's going to have to make a pit stop before long. He's run just about as long as he can. He never got back on the...
He's gone 47 laps.
He's just gone just about as long as he can go, and he's going to have to drop in and make a pit stop here shortly.
Right, hopeful. There he goes. Yep, you're right. He may be out of fuel because that's the backstretch.
Yep, he ran out of fuel. They ran him out of fuel again. They did that one other time this year.
He's trying to slosh enough fuel in the pickup. Yep. To get him back to the pit area.
Yeah. Well, we know the Chevrolets can't run 47 laps here anyway.
We know he can't run 48 laps. Yeah. He ran 47.
Yeah, he ran 47. Tough break for him. I mean, he did everything he could do. I mean, he did everything in his power to get that thing back up there and challenge to win this race. It just wasn't going to be in the cards here tonight. This is going to be a kind of a lucky break for everybody else because they're going to get... the yellow flag that they need for their final pit stop. Tough break for him, good break for everybody else, because there won't be any more green flag laps after this. They'll be able to go to the end.
So the fourth yellow of the afternoon here on lap 156, and that is for a toe-in on the Bensville Panther number 4 of Thomas Schechter, who has had a tough afternoon here at Michigan. Schechter, one of the fastest drivers on this racetrack, will end up being towed back to the pit area.
Yeah.
The fourth yellow of the afternoon, the first two for Debris, and Franchitti stalled, but we actually had some slight contact between Mira and Castroneves, and that brought out the third yellow. And now our fourth yellow of the afternoon here on lap 156, so this will be their final pit stop. They'll be good to go the distance. And we'll have a shootout and see if, but when you talk about what can happen, we've talked about a set of tires that maybe not quite up to snuff. If they get a set of tires on Kanaan's car...
Well, anything can happen. So far...
It ain't over until that checker flag comes
out. That's right. But so far, he has been pretty dominant. He's been very, very good. He's withheld everybody who's tried to pass him. He's been able to hold them off. When it comes to good luck, he's got it. When it comes to bad luck, that
Thomas
guy right there is at just about all anybody can stand in one year.
he'll let go of that rope too soon.
He's going to make it back, but you know, it's too late now. He's already another two or three laps down, so he's
three laps off the base right now. He'll come back probably four laps.
Up until that happened, he still had some sort of a chance. Well, the pits are open, and he's still coasting in. That could cause some problems for some of the guys that pit close to him.
He'll duck into the pits and let the Pennzoil Panther guys go to work on his car and top off that fuel, get him back in competition. One lap 158. Canaan, where he's been all day with the exception of six laps, is out in front. So let's see if he can maintain that lead on this yellow flag pit stop. As you see, they're on the backstretch right now, headed into turn three as they'll peel off and head for the pits. Canaan, Rice, Fernandez is up to third, then Hornish, Weldon, and Matsura has dropped to sixth. Live coverage of the Michigan Indy 400. Anticipating the final pit stop as they peel off behind the pace vehicle. And now after topping off the fuel, they have Schechter back underway, but he now is three laps off the pace.
Yep, so he's out of the contention. He's out of contention now, no question about it. All of these guys coming into the pits right now, though, there's about...
Another problem. This is the third problem in the pits this afternoon, and again, it was Fernandez, one of the most veteran drivers in this field.
Yeah,
it looked like he just locked the brakes up and spun it.
That's exactly what it looked like.
I don't think there's any contact. I think it was him.
And I think he just, he almost took his teammate Matsura with him.
Well, Canaan got back out as we were watching that action. Canaan got back out in the lead. Rice is second. Oh, my. Fernandez just took himself out of contention.
Mira, whatever his trouble is, they don't seem to be too big a hurry in there. Now Fernandez is going to get back out. He's still going to be on the lead lap, unless they mess up again here. But he's going to be in. Don't spin it out again there. He got he's really mad at himself.
But you know, Larry, that is so uncharacteristic of a veteran driver like this.
Yeah, it really is. He's done. He's had two errors.
Let's take a look again.
He's just trying to beat Team Penske in there, and he just locked him up. Oh, look at that.
Knocked down another one.
He knocked somebody else down.
Oh, man. We've had so many pit guys hit today. Oh! And that was the worst of the bunch right there.
Yeah.
Had he not had that helmet on.
Yeah. And that's Matsura. That's his own...
That's his own crew member.
His own crew member.
Because he is the team owner. Matsura is the team driver.
Well, that's that's a huge mental error for a veteran like that. There's no excuse for that, really.
All right, here it is, slow motion.
He's trying to be casting there, Hornish into the pit area. He's just out dragging him. Now he's trying to outbrake him to get in there.
At that helmet hit the ground.
That was...
Had it not been for that helmet.
Right. And look at Fernandez's crew members. He's running over to help his friend here to see if he's okay, because he saw that accident. He knows
there's... Well, look what he did. He goes right back to work on the right front.
Yeah.
Right back to his assignment.
Yeah, and his leg's hurt. He crawled over there because he couldn't get up and walk. So...
He's going to have a headache tomorrow. This is just, we know how dangerous the pits can be, and today certainly has underscored that with how many drivers hitting crew members.
Brian Barnhart is going to have some things to say about that.
Harsh things.
And I would not be surprised if he doesn't have some fines for some of these guys, because some of this was just dumb. Dumb stuff.
That last one for sure.
Well,
and then Takagi to begin with.
Exactly.
When he hit
Fernandez was up to third. He was just trying to gain another spot. And I know the pit stops are important, but...
He's going to restart in 13th position now after coming in third.
So, in the end, all he did was cost himself a bunch of positions on the racetrack.
There's a look at Taylor, who's five laps off the pace. Only one driver out of this race. That's Franchitti. You heard him say he thought the engine went sour. He kept slowing down on the racetrack, and then he really slowed from that in-car camera shot.
Right. Do have everybody else running pretty well, and we are going to have 13 cars on the lead lap. And really, of that 13, any one of them can still win this race. Fernandez, even though he's in the back, he's been pretty strong. Mira may be the only guy that doesn't have a chance, because I think he's got some damaged suspension from that contact in the pits earlier.
So it's Kanaan, Rice, Hornish, Weldon, Bell. Good ride for Townsend Bell. He's back in fifth position in this restart. Then Castroneves. Then Manning, Herta, Sharp, Dixon, Matsura, Mira, Fernandez, and Giafone. Giafone got his lap back under these yellows, so there's one lap to go as they complete lap 161.
Well, we'll see if there's any tricks in the bag, because if there are any tricks,
it's time to pull them out,
because with 40 laps to go, Rice, Hornish, Weldon, Castroneves, all those guys got to figure out some way to get around Tony Kanaan. It'll be interesting to see, because I think they've got any tricks. They're going to pull them out right away.
Once they go green, Larry, we're hearing now from race control that Fernandez will be black flagged, so he'll be brought in for a stop and go penalty.
Well, well deserved. What he did was not a smart
that
thing.
That likely won't be the only penalty he'll get.
No, I think probably not, because he was actually trying to race Hornish down the pit lane, and just almost hurt one of his own crew guys.
All right, let's see what Rice has on this restart for Kanaan.
He got a run on him. Let's see if he can make it work. This may be his only chance.
The first time for half. Well, maybe not.
He did this one other time. Remember the last restart, he had a chance to get around him. Just pulled up beside him, but just could not have enough speed.
Kanaan has not been passed on the racetrack. There will be a stop-and-go penalty assessed for Fernandez, number five.
Now then,
look at Hornish on the inside, takes second position.
Well, this
Hornish goes to second, Rice drops to third, Weldon now is in fourth. All right, the question now is, Larry, who's going to finish second?
Yeah. The top 10 guys all right there in this huge, big bunch of cars.
They all have a shot at second place. I'm not sure anybody has a shot for the lead.
Yeah.
Here's Adrian Fernandez, his stop and go being assessed.
Yeah.
Official is right there, and he's told to get back out, so that was a penalty for what happened earlier.
Essentially a one-lap penalty for what he did.
Yeah, because here comes the field.
And you can see the top 10 or 11 cars all right there together. There is Townsend Bell.
Townsend Bell back in sixth position.
It looks to be pretty strong. He uses that grab to pull up right behind Castroneves.
An eventful day for Elio, who started at the back of the pack in the 20th position, but has driven most of the race in the top five or six. Right now he's in the fifth position.
Look at this, still two and three wide. Scott Dixon goes to the bottom of the racetrack.
That's Weldon you're looking at there in the Klein Tools, number 26. And that is the number two of Taylor, who's a lap off the pace. In fact, Taylor now is five laps off the pace. So they want him to get the heck out of the way and let them go racing. And I'm sure that race control is probably saying that to him.
That's Townsend Bell. Taylor drove that earlier in the year, but that's Townsend Bell who's running in fifth place.
Good correction. Yeah, that was the car that Taylor was in earlier.
He was in the
season.
Got fired and moved to the 13 Access Motorsports car. So Townsend Bell, the lone Chevrolet, leading running in this lead pack now that Thomas Schechter is more or less out of it.
Runs in second, but guys, you can't gain on the guy in the point standings when he's gaining three bonus points while he's the most laps, and he's going to end up winning this thing. That's 50 points right there, so he's going to go away from this race perhaps with a bigger lead than what he had coming in, and that was 64 points.
Yeah, look at Dixon. He's showing a little horsepower now as he and Castroneves both go around Townsend Bell, and Dixon moves up into fourth spot.
So it's Kanaan, Rice, Hornish, Dixon, Castroneves, then Bell, Manning, Weldon, Herta, and Sharp. Now, how about this ride for Sharp? He's just stayed out there and kept his nose clean, and he's up in 10th position.
Yeah, he's probably the best run he's had all year. He's had a tough year, but he's on the lead lap. and not really in this lead pack right now, but still having a good run.
He's finished ninth on three occasions this season, and right now Sharp is in the 10th position.
Well, here you see it. Dixon falls right in line.
And that's what these guys will have to do if they have a shot at closing in on Kanaan.
Kanaan's just been so dominant. And right now...
There's Adrian right out in front of Kanaan.
And he's actually helping Tony Kanaan as Kanaan's using him to draft off of.
Well, he's at the tail end of the lead lap. Now he's going to go on by, maybe. And Kanaan's not going to let... Adrian's not going to make it easy.
Well... Kanaan's strong enough, he's just going to pull back down in front of him.
That was a lap car between Kanaan and Rice. Here comes Rice, back there in second. Third is Hornish, then Dixon, then Castroneves. As now Dixon closes.
Dixon has looked, this is by far the best race we've seen him run all year. He's really looked pretty good all day long. Castroneves goes to the outside of him, though. Manning right behind him, his teammate.
And all the while, Rice is closing in on Kanaan. Rice now just that margin of about, five car lengths, which represents about 0.17 seconds off the leader.
Yeah, he's gaining on him. He's been able to do that all day long. When he got out by himself, you can catch the draft from 10 car lengths back. And he's been catching that draft and been able to suck up on him going down the straightaways. As you see right there, he gains maybe a car length down the straightaway, maybe a little more. But then it gets into the corner, he loses about that same amount of time going through the corner.
Look at this, couple of teams stacked up there in almost contact between the target cars. I start talking about the teammates, and they almost took each other out.
Man.
Dixon on the inside of Manning.
Darren Manning would not be a very popular man if he took out both cars right there, as they did almost touch going through that corner, running side by side.
The Penske cars are third and fourth.
He got a huge run coming off of two there. That's what he's been doing the last couple of laps, getting a huge run off the corner.
And he rides back in sixth position. He has his teammate out in front from the two Penske cars. Hornish is third. Castroneves is fourth. Still Kanaan, where he's been all day up in front. Rice is second.
This is where Manning's been getting this run, through one and two. Again, a huge, got through there much faster than Dixon did. Just blew on by Dixon that time.
I'll see if he can get to run the next lap to get up close to challenge the Penske cars. So Honda Power out in front. Honda's in second. Toyota Power is third, fourth, fifth, sixth. Best Chevy right now is seventh, Townsend Bell.
Well, let's see what happens here. Is Manning, he's going to get this run again. Is he going to go three wide? Yes, he is. See if he can make this work. He got it pretty high that time. They forced him way too high. He didn't want to be up that high on the racetrack.
Down the back stretch, which is banked 5 degrees into the 18-degree banking. Watch those cars up in front hit the banking. As the two Penske cars are still side by side for third position.
Darren Manning still trying to find a way around both those Penske cars. Now then, it looks like he's got around one.
Around one of them. He got by Hornish. He's going to stay on the high side. He's going to duck back in behind Castroneves. He tucks in behind Castroneves. There's Hornish. Kanaan still enjoying almost a 0.2 second lead over Rice on lap 176. Just over 25 laps to go.
Rice has just been about maintaining that three car length second position. Now then, Manning all of a sudden seems to be as fast or faster than anybody on the racetrack. So he just passed both Penske cars here in the last couple of laps.
Last lap, the fastest driver was Masura, who's back and mired in 10th position. And look at Dixon to the inside of Hornish.
Got a good run down there,
and
here comes
Dan Weldon.
All depends on the kind of draft you get, your position on the racetrack. That's what's made this room.
That wasn't quite as close as it looked
with
the camera angle.
No, it didn't. But
look at Rice. Look at Rice and look at Fernandez. Fernandez could play a spoiler in this thing.
Yeah, I think
he tucks in behind Rice and helps Rice to get around Kanaan.
Well,
it's
we'll
not going to help if he goes three wide, though.
We'll see what happens here if the rest of the lead pack catches up with these two guys. I would think that the smart thing to do would be for Fernandez to get the heck out of the way and let them race for the lead. But right now, he's not hurting anybody by running with these with the leaders. Because Buddy
right
Rice...
Now he's a lap off the pace. Back in 13th, want to hear from Kim Green again, the co-owner of the Andretti Green team that has led this race all but six laps. Rice is still second, so what is Fernandez going to do? Is he going to play a spoiler? Is he going to get out of the way? Is he going to help the 15 car slide by the 11?
Well, I don't think there's going to be much sliding by the 11 car. If you do it, you're going to have to use something that nobody's found yet here today.
And you get those other two cars or four cars stacked up side by side, they're not going to gain on these these three guys. Laps click away down to 179.
Calculating being done here. How close is it going to be for you guys on fuel?
Well, I think hopefully it's close for everybody. I'm a bit shame about that because we've got a great car. I'd like to just race to the finish, but it's very, very close. We've got to keep working hard out there.
I heard an engineer a moment ago say, can we run lap 200 on fumes? Is it going to be that close?
It could be. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. We'll be trying.
Tony Kanaan.
Well, Mr. Rice, we thought they had the fuel to go the distance.
Well, yeah, they pitted with, they're going to have to run 42 laps. Depending on if you run your fuel mixture full rich, which I think about everybody is, just so they can keep up with everybody, it could be,
well,
who
he
knows?
Would have gone at the checkered flag. He would have gone 42 laps.
We kind of badmouthed Fernandez for getting in a mess here, but we're going to say something good now. When that second group caught up with him, he just pulled to the outside and let them all go. That was very good sportsmanship on Adrian Fernandez's part. He had no way to win this race. He just pulled up, let that second group of cars go. Now then, we've got all of a sudden about a six-car race, and he's not in the middle of it.
Yeah, and look, they've all closed in now. They're able to close in on Rice, despite running side-by-side in some cases.
And here comes Dixon going around his teammate.
But can they get around Kanaan? And now, can Kanaan go the distance?
Well, you know, it might be one of these cars that are running back here and just
like Dan Weldon.
He's running back there in seventh place. He's not really challenging anybody. He may be just running in the draft, running on a real lean fuel mixture, trying to hope that he can have enough fuel and everybody else.
Trying to wake up later and go full rich.
So, you know, a lot of games being played, a lot of strategy being played out here. And maybe that's the reason some of these guys in the back have
almost contact right there between the two team cars.
Oh, man,
that's two or three times this afternoon they've almost gotten together again.
Well, we've seen Darren Manning have contact.
Well, he bounced off everybody on the race.
Yeah, he's had contact several times here this year, and doing it with your teammate would not be a good thing.
Chip Ganassi would not be too fond of that. We have 17 laps to go.
Yeah, here comes Dan Weldon again. Now, he's a guy that's been kind of motoring around back there in the back. Maybe he's decided it's time to make his move. I shouldn't say motoring around in the back, but he's not challenged for the lead here in the last several laps.
16 laps to go. They have raced with him, but no one has passed Tony Kanaan on the racetrack this afternoon. He lost the lead in the pits. He's led all but six laps here at Michigan.
Look at this. Again, Dixon and Manning side by side. Rice trying to figure out a way. He's run up behind him. He's run up beside him a couple of times on restarts, but never has he been able to make any kind of a real move.
Well, you saw how close that finish was last year.
Well, here comes Hornish now. He's on the outside. As, those guys back there, really, whoo, look at them, Dyson back and forth. That was Manning, went out to the outside, back to the inside. It looks like there's maybe some trouble with Castroneves. He's falling back a little bit. or he may have turned the fuel down on full lean to save some fuel, because he has fallen back to sixth spot and looks like he's fallen back even further. So he may have decided, I can't win this thing by passing him, so maybe I'll win it by outsmarting him and saving a little fuel. We'll see.
Is that his call, or is that a call from the...
Don't know. That's probably a call from Roger Penske. Probably a call from Roger Penske. He's going to let Hornish go up there and battle with him, try to pass him. He'll turn one car, turn the fuel down, maybe try to outlast him with fuel. I'm sure they know exactly what these new Toyotas are getting for fuel mileage. Obviously, Kanaan has run more laps than anybody else on most of these pit stops, so seems like if he can't make it, then I wouldn't think anybody else could make it.
All the leaders have gone 29 laps since their last pit stop, so to the conclusion of this race, they would have 42 laps on this tank of fuel.
And they had about two or three under the yellow, so I would think most of them could do it, but maybe not. I was thinking that they ran 42 laps with a couple of yellow flag laps earlier.
12 laps to go. And again, Dixon looks high, but every time he looks high, he loses some ground. Tucks back in front of Dixon. Rice can tuck back behind. There you go, in front of Dixon. Runs single file. Look at Mira. Mira back to sixth position.
We thought he had some sort of trouble. Here's Matsura. He's come
Matsura
in.
Matsura does have trouble.
He's had to replace the front wing. Obviously, he made some contact with somebody. But, we thought Mira might have had some trouble after that contact in the pits because he fell way back. But he might have been one of the other guys who was also thinking of fuel and turned the wick down for several laps and trying to conserve fuel. Now then, all of a sudden, he's right back in the hunt.
And look at this.
Buddy
Tried
Rice.
To get alongside with 11 laps to go.
Well, Buddy Rice, this is the first time all day long we've seen him pull up beside Tony Kanaan under race conditions and actually look like he is going to lead a lap under race conditions. So Buddy Rice, that's the closest thing to a pass we've seen all day long. And look at this, we got another four cars behind him all stacked up trying to do the same thing.
So Rice led out, he's still out in front. Look at this.
This is the first time in 190 laps that anybody's been able to pull out and pass Tony Kanaan.
Now, if Tony Kanaan gets the three bonus points for leading the most laps, that's not what he's concerned with right now. He's concerned that Buddy Rice is putting some distance between first and second.
Wow. Hornish.
Look at this stack up. Look how high they are on the racetrack. And look at Schechter. That's got his way up there.
Well, he's got...
The last lap, Schechter was the fastest driver on the racetrack.
Well, You'd like to see him prove that he can still go up there and pass these guys, but you don't want him messing up the race at this point either. So,
yeah, this is not a race you want to finish under yellow.
No. Well, Buddy Rice, with 10 laps to go, has made his move. Now we'll see if that move was something that Tony Kanaan let him do because of fuel mileage. Or if it's, maybe he's playing the odds. Maybe he doesn't think that Buddy Rice can make it to the end. He's going to let him run out of fuel and take the lead back. We just don't know. Whatever.
Well, that is a big gap to make up right there unless somebody comes up and helps him.
Yeah. All of a sudden, Buddy Rice just absolutely pulled out and went by.
Tony Rice came into this race in second place in the point standings. 64 markers behind Tony Kanaan. There's 10 points between first and second place, but three are negated by, so he could gain 7 points on him.
Yeah, well, he's certainly doing everything he can to win the championship by winning races, and that's all you can do at this point. Tony Kanaan certainly done his part, as he dominated this race all day long. Until 10 laps to go, was the first time he was passed on the racetrack by anybody.
Look at Darren Manning.
Showing a little oats of his own as he's on the outside of Hornish.
This is for third spot. His teammates right behind there. Dixon and Weldon going at it. Mira's back in seventh. guys. We're working on lap 195. Five laps left to go this time by. Five laps remaining, and look at the gap between first and second. Almost a half second. And that's a lot of ground to make up in five laps.
Yeah, it is. And you can see these guys back here running side by side. They're not helping their cause. As Vito Mirra right now, he's not very happy with Thomas Schechter. He wants him to get the heck out of the way because obviously Thomas does not have a chance to win.
Now we're also hearing from Gary that Rice will be very tight on fuel.
Well, I think
all these guys may be kind of tight.
Well, I think they're all going to be tight. The first two are Hondas, the second three, the next three are Toyotas. So we'll see if Toyota... I think with Toyota making the changes to their engines, they probably have less of an idea what kind of fuel mileage they're going to get. I would think that Honda, both Rice and Tanon, would have a pretty good idea about where they are.
They all ran out of fuel from the Chevy at Belleville, and he'll go from 10th spot where he is now to win this thing.
Chevrolet normally has, I think they've gotten about the worst fuel mileage of anybody, but once again, they've worked on these things. They've made a lot of changes to them, so I don't think anybody knows.
Tanon has won three races this year. Number 15 of Rice, they of course won two, including the Indianapolis 500. Just battling back for position. But now 197 in the book, going on 198.
Boy, I tell you, Thomas Schechter's right in the middle of that thing, and that's he's going to make some of those other drivers very angry because they're racing for position, and he's three laps down.
I think that Brian would tell him to get out of there.
You would think so.
He is three laps off the pace back in
Kanaan
position.
Kanaan is catching.
Contact right there, but oh my.
Mirra, Castroneves touching. Man, oh man.
Two laps to go.
Look at this.
With two laps to go. Down the backstretch on the high side, Kanaan trying to take the advantage away from the 15 of Rice. Rice goes back around. He has a short way around.
Was he just playing with him? Was he just letting him go around just to make...
White flag contact. There was contact right there. Did I not see something on the front car?
It looked like something flew up the racetrack right there. I agree with you. I'm not sure. Maybe it was something that was already on the racetrack.
Last lap. This is it. Can Rice hang on? Can Rice hold him off? And we have to watch for blocking, but, you know, Kanaan's the master of blocking, so down the backstretch.
He's moved to the outside. We'll see if he's got anything. I don't think so. I don't think he can do this. Rice, unless he runs out of fuel here in the last few hundred feet.
Rice is going to win it. Rice takes the victory, the third of the year. Kanaan will take second, Weldon third, Hornish fourth, Mirra comes back to finish fifth, Herta was sixth, and Dixon Bell Sharp, Castroneves was 10th, and those 10 drivers were on the lead lap.
Unbelievable that Buddy Rice, I thought it when Kanaan came back, he fell back, he caught him, he went on by him. I thought he was just going to, had been playing with him, was going to go back by, but he could not complete the pass. And Buddy Rice did what he had to do to win the race. You got to give him a lot of credit. He drove a heck of a race. He was very patient. He never got frustrated. He didn't do anything when he got up beside Kanaan and he pulled away. Kanaan pulled away. He didn't lose his concentration. A good job. Both those are two real professional, good race car drivers. They both did a great job there today.
Well, there's the guy that won the Indianapolis 500 and a chance to visit with President George Bush at the White House a couple of weeks ago, and he's going to do some donuts along the front stretch there, much to the delight of all the fans here at Michigan.
Couldn't have been too low on fuel. He's still got enough to do that. So.
This didn't kill the engine here. I wonder how much this actually cost. These donuts actually cost.
I don't know.
In repair jobs.
Well, you think they'd have to replace all the half shafts and U-joints and everything else after they do all that stuff.
And he's got enough fuel to take a victory lap.
Yeah.
And he's still waving.
Well.
Oh, what a great race. And what a great race, despite the fact that Tony Kanaan led all but about 16 laps.
Yeah, and it was right to the end. Those two guys pulled away from everybody else, no question about it. But But they, Weldon, he did a great job. He'd been back to seventh place and got back up to third.
Look at the smoke still enveloping. The fans are on the front straightaway after the burnouts.
Confirmation of the race win then, Pooh Bradley Rice from Tony Kanaan, Dan Weldon, Sam Hornish, Vita Mira, Brian Herter finished in sixth place, Scott Dixon, the reigning champion, in seventh. Townsend Bell, a good shout for Townsend Bell. He had a good solid drive as well there, finishing in eighth place. Scott Sharp, Elio Castroneves, Darren Manning in the end dropping to 13th, a disaster for him. Thomas Schechter, well, I'm sure we're going to read a little bit more about that in the press this week as well. Mark Taylor in 21st place, and Dario Franchitti, we know, had a motor.